Cooper Webb, and I choose OGIO.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Dean Wilson.
I'm Aaron Plessinger.
I'm Darren Martin.
I'm Nate Thrasher.
I'm Shane McElrath.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
My name's Jet Lawrence.
I'm Jordan Smith.
I'm Talon Hawkins.
Stargate Hampshire.
I'm Hayden Deegan.
I'm Colt Nichols.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Tom Diala. I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Jiren Ferrangis. And I choose OGIO.
Welcome to the SML Show, presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Today I'm joined by Cade Clason of the Partzilla PRMX Kawasaki team. And he is fresh off the Anaheim One main event. So I was joking around in our little, you know, we have a Swapmoto Live group chat with me, Chase, Anton, and A-Ray. And I'm all, this is the first time I've cheered so hard for Cade Clason, because I'm usually cheering against him because I want Alex to make the main, but dude, that has to be one of the career highlights for you.
It was good. You know, it was with the way how bad my heat race went, and I didn't really ride good in practice either. I finally kind of showed up for that race, and I saw Freddie, and I just kind of locked into him and tried to not pay attention to who was behind me until the last lap. Because I think if I would have started thinking about it, it would have went bad. But it was definitely cool. I mean, I don't really care who I beat or who I don't, you know what I mean? I want to get the job done. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think I gained like 300 or 400 followers yesterday. So, I mean, the amount of people that just like, you know, came on to say it was congratulations or whatever is really cool.
Does your mechanic signal you, Hunter Lawrence closing in, or did you look back, or did you hear the crowd and know something was up?
I mean, I knew he was coming either way. I mean, I knew he was in the race, and I knew he wasn't in front of me. Normally, I look at my pit board religiously, like every single lap. But as soon as I got by, I think it was like Claremont or something like that, I knew I had to go because I knew he was probably coming. And when I was entering the second set of whoops, I could see him exiting the first set, I think with like two to go. And like kind of like an oh no feeling set in. And I was like, I know how hard I race LCQs against like my friends. So to like have to wonder like, man, am I gonna be able to plow into Hunter Lawrence to stay in fourth for the LCQ if he catches me, was a thought that crossed my head. Because I mean, you know, we'll chop each other's heads off for the last spot, yeah, you know, but doing that to somebody who makes, you know, a lot more money than the rest of us is a little different. And I think Feld and AMA would probably look at it a little differently too, but I'm glad it didn't come down to that.
Yeah. Going into the sand, white flag lap, what are your thoughts?
I thought I had more room than I did, honestly. When I rewatch it, I hit the wall and I had like over a second, it felt like, and he absolutely smoked me in the sand. Like he got so close, and when I doubled in after the sand is when I noticed how close he was. And I kind of got lucky because all practice, on my last fast lap, I'd cut the inside before the finish line to try and, you know, cut the corner and make it faster. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because my team manager and crew chief both gave me crap for it. They're like, why are you doing that? Like, it's not faster here. And I was like, all right, sorry. And then after the LCQ, and I was like, well, hey, man, at least I knew how to cut the inside super well. But yeah, it just like, I don't think he's the guy who's going to like if A-Ray was behind me right there, I almost feel like I would have been more nervous, because I think he would have just absolutely ran into the side of me and I would have flipped over into the berm. I think Hunter was just really nice about it. I mean, I was nervous for sure, but I mean, I think he was just a little nice for the situation.
Yeah. So I think Anton probably said something already, but we see you go to the finish line, you're like, yes. But then after Hunter passes you, then you really do the fist pumps.
It was kind of like surreal because, you know, qualifying almost 30th, it's like you almost don't the majority of the year last year, I'm like, I want in every single weekend. Mm-hmm. But like yesterday it was like, or Saturday, it's, you know, it's like I kind of want to just make it through the day and do the best that I can. And if I make it, great. So like, it was one of those situations where like, dude, I like all this weight kind of got lifted off my shoulders. Cause I mean, it's deep right now. Like not just factory guys, but also like the amount of good privateers that are riding 450s. So it felt good to just earn that the first weekend of the year.
Yeah. You mentioned it, right? It's so deep. Like coming into it, I was like, hey, Alex, are you just pumped you're not racing? Because I mean, look at all the number of factory guys and then all the steady, rock steady privateer dudes, right? Was it kind of nerve-wracking coming into this season? Like, you've always been one of the guys that makes it in, you know, like most of the time. But like to really look at all the people moving up and stuff.
It was definitely nerve-wracking. I thought I got off my world's bike and got on the new Cowie and felt really good. I rode it really well at South of the Border with Yoder and Mitchell, and I felt really fast, but you never really know until you get there, right? You know, you could be off by just a little bit in practice and not make the night show. I think I was like a second and a half faster than 40th, and I was like 27th or something. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't take much to just have a bad lap or not ride a practice and then you're not racing at all. But I knew I'd be okay once I got into the races because I feel like I'm better in motos than I am in practice anyways. Mm-hmm. But it's stressful, man. Like you never truly know, especially when you just practice with the same two guys every day, really how fast you're going. I mean, you can practice as much as you want and race a stopwatch, but once you get on a new track that has all these different obstacles and you might be a little uncomfortable. You really have no idea how fast you're going to go.
Yeah. What main event was out for you? Do you keep track?
I don't keep track. No, I have no idea, honestly. I mean, I think I've made 13 the last 2 years. Mm-hmm. And then I made like six, two of the years before that. So I don't have nearly as many as, say, Alex, mm-hmm. you know, because I missed 2 years of Supercross. But, you know, I think if I can keep, you know, get a good year this year and next year, I'll start having a good number. You know, I think Starling has like almost 100. I definitely really? Don't have that many. Wow.
Okay. You mentioned getting on the new Cowie, right? The KX 450 is all new for 24. It's gotten rave reviews for handling and being connected to the ground, but kind of so-so with the engine. Before the show, you said you raced a stock engine. You have a pipe?
I got a pipe.
Okay.
Rode it for the first time at the race.
No way.
Yeah, we couldn't get one. Bills didn't have one made yet. They didn't have a bike to make a jig or anything like that. So we actually got out here and they took them my race bike to basically build it on the bike. So that's how they built their first Cowie 450 pipe for the new frame. But yeah, I love the new frame. I'm not going to say I didn't like the last frame because I did like my bike last year. I just think I had it way too stiff. But I really just wanted a better front end feel so I could trust the front end a little bit more. Mm-hmm. And the new frame, it feels like the front wheel is more under you, kind of like how the Honda feels, how it's like a little more front end heavy. Maybe not quite that exaggerated, but it's just, it handles so well. And even this weekend, like it's so good in the whoops. Like I skimmed the whoops the whole main. Like, I wasn't skimming them like Jet was skimming them. But, I mean, usually I would resort to jumping instantly. And that's not how it went this weekend. And I was pretty proud of myself for that. But I liked what I was riding. And I trusted that I was riding well. And they had my race motor done, I think, on Wednesday. And they were like, oh, you can ride it on Thursday. And I'm like, honestly, like, I'd rather just race what I'm, like, trust, like, what I know, what I trust. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, like I said, I'm going to ride the new engine tomorrow and the next day and see how it goes. You know, if I'm not totally comfortable on it, I'll probably just race the stock engine again because I have a lot of faith in it and I'm comfortable on it and I got good starts this weekend. So I'm not going to go away from something that I like to try to make something better.
Yeah.
Just rush it. I'm going to do it right.
Yeah. What a testament to that is really though, like modern bikes, like a relatively stock 450 qualifies for Anaheim One 450 main event.
But, yeah.
All right, we're going to take a quick break, give everyone our sponsors. Back for more with Cade. Hey guys, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. So, dude, back to the bike. Let's talk bikes a little bit more. What do you want out of your race motor? Like, what are you telling them? You want more low? Or?
Yeah, so I just want more low-end power. I ride so luggy, like a vet rider almost, mm-hmm. that I want it to have a little bit more snap without having to, like, clutch pop it. Especially like when I do want to jump whoops, I don't want to have to clutch pop in between the whoops to get that pop.
Yeah.
I don't want to have to come out of a corner and like give it that little extra clutch to get the revs up, you know, to sit a three in that's a little steep. Mm-hmm. If I can just trust the throttle, I'd rather do it all with the throttle than have to worry about clutching it too. Makes it a little easier for me. Mm-hmm. That's really all I need. Like I don't need a rocket ship. I rode somebody's like full-blown race Yamaha 450, and I rode a Yamaha a couple years ago and I loved it, but this thing was so fast that I was like, I don't know how you ride this thing. Like, it's too much power. Like I want to be able to be aggressive, and like we're not using all the power that those bikes make anyways, so it's almost like if you give it all this power, it's pointless. Mm-hmm. So I have 20 hours on my practice bike, and that's the bike I raced. I raced my practice bike with 20 hours on it. All he did was put a new clutch in it, and it was sick.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if you trust something, it's almost better than having a whole bunch of power that you're not comfy with. Because mm-hmm. most of those guys, they have a stock practice bike and then this ripper race bike, and it's like you get on it and you don't know how to ride it.
Yeah. Talk about the rest of your program with the team. Like, what are you in that OG gear again?
No, so we're not in OG. We're in Pure Adrenaline. So they're custom making all of our stuff. So it's all sublimated. It's really nice. I like it. I mean, uh-huh. I have no issues with that
stuff.
Is it
kind of a company that's utilizing like canvas?
Yeah, perhaps? So they are for us. I believe they make some of their own stuff as well, but all of our stuff is sublimated through them. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, we're back with Arai. We're wearing Liat boots. And then some under Liat stuff as well. They came on pretty last minute, but they did like the whole team, so it was really cool. And I actually really like the boots. I had never worn them before, and I'm not a super picky guy because I know some guys have specific boot preferences. Mm. But I actually really like them. They're probably stiffer than boots I've worn in the past, and they're lighter than stay like an A-Star, which that's my biggest thing is I'm already a big guy. I don't want to make stuff a lot heavier than mm-hmm. it needs to be. So our gear setup's pretty chill, and I don't know how well you know Julian, the owner of the team, but he's just making strides to be, you know, a really legit team. You know, he mm-hmm. cut back this year, so there's only four of us. There's Tanti and I, who are supposed to ride the 450s, Mitchell, Harrison, and Yoder mm-hmm. On the 250s, and Mitchell raced a 450 this weekend just because Aaron was hurt. And we've just been training together at South of the Border, and it's kind of got that like star feeling where everyone works together and we're all training together, trying to push each other at one place. And, you know, I know Julian's trying to build this team into, you know, a team that can be compared with the factory bikes. And, you know, I think, you know, Yoder got, what, 12th this weekend, I think, and I went out and made the 450 main against 16 factory bikes. So, you know, I think we're making strides in the right direction. People give us a hard time because we run WP suspension on the Cowies, but Tim does all of our stuff from TCD. I don't know if you ever met Tim, but
I don't think so.
I've known him since I was.
So are you running cone valve air or cone valve spring?
Spring.
Spring. Yeah, spring. They're good.
Yeah, they are good. Yeah. I mean, I loved them on the KTM a few years ago. We raced with them last year, and we're racing with them again this year. And my biggest thing last year was I just made them too stiff. And this year, I think my bike handles, like, I might not have top end speed like I did last year, but I gave that up a little bit to be more comfortable in the races when the track breaks down a little bit. But it's like, that's just a learning thing, right? And I want to be more comfortable. And if I have to push my bike over the edge a little bit to get speed sometimes, I will. But I think that was something I was trying to be smarter with my testing this year, was just making the bike comfortable for me and not super stiff so I could just pound into things and be wide open all the time. Because you can't, I can't do that for a whole main event, you know? I think personally that works better for me.
You know, I think when Cowie had the really bad SFF air fork, I had WP suspension on my test bike that I rode all year, and I loved it, right? It was cone valve spring. But it was funny because every time I put it on my Instagram, Chad Reed would DM me like, "You're breaking family code, mate." Like, you know, you should have KYB from your brother on there. But, you know, I don't know. I really liked it. So,
I mean, it's, I think some people just like feel like, oh, this stuff has to be on this bike and this stuff. W, they think WP, you know, has to be on a KTM or a gas gas just because that's what the factory teams run. But, you know, like I said, Tim's been working really hard with the team to make sure our stuff is top notch. And I think it is.
Okay. So, obviously, with our buddy A-Ray retiring and, you know, starting his journey at O'Neill, and, you know, we supplement his income a little bit here. But, like, I was talking to him one day. I'm like, dude, is it less stressful now because you have a guaranteed paycheck? And he goes, absolutely, right? So, like, I, like, think you and A-Ray are about the same level guy before. And so I asked him, for like, how did you make money? Because it's not from Supercross purse money, per se. It's from bonuses or, you know, and he said it was gear contracts, et cetera. But how long do you see yourself doing this at this level? And is it stressful? Is it, I mean, is your wife carrying you?
No, I mean, it's definitely stressful because, so like my contract, I don't make any money if I get hurt, which sucks as a rider, but it kind of just, you know, you have to take the blows sometimes. But I mean, I mean, I do pretty good for myself. I won't say I don't. I mean, I think some guys stretch it a little thin and say like, oh, we don't make any money. And that's not true. Like, you know, I make pretty good money and Julian takes really good care of me. And, you know, it's, I'm married and I live on the East Coast. So like affordability of living is so much better than out here. So I used to give him crap all the time. I'm like, dude, you golf five times a week and live in the most expensive place in the country. Like, no wonder it's hard to afford to live. But I have a 2-year deal with the team. So this year and next year. And I'll see, man. I love riding my dirt bike. But as I've gotten older, I have thought about what I want to do afterwards. And I don't have like a dead set plan on what I want to do. I definitely want to be in the sport. I've always kind of dreamed of being a team manager or a crew chief or something like that because I'm super OCD about a lot of team things. And it makes Julian and Craig from the team really mad because like, I'm like, dude, this is what you guys need to do. Like, why are you guys not doing it this way?
You're the writer.
And they're like, well, you need to worry about doing your job. And then they end up doing it that way half the time anyways. And I'm just like, I was like, you could just say thank you. I think I would be really good at something like that, but I'm obviously going to ride out my contract and then, you know, see kind of where we're at. But I just love riding too much. And I see like Chiz, who's like right in front of me, still going strong. And I just see plenty of room in me for improvement that I just don't want to quit and then ever. I definitely don't want to be that guy that retires and comes back
yeah.
or like has a ton of regret that I didn't give it all the time and all the effort that I have.
Yeah, cool. One last break and we'll have one more section with Cade. Welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Okay, I wanted to ask you something. After one of the practices, you and
Cartwright,
I saw some finger pointing and some yelling. At your level with guys that are all in the main event bubble, some tempers flare sometimes, but you're all buddies, aren't you?
Yeah, we're all boys. I messed up and I cleaned him out pretty decent in free practice, and I was like trying to avoid arguing with him on the floor because I don't like if I'm gonna argue with you, we're gonna argue back at our trucks where like no one's like gonna film us, and you know we can. I hate arguing in the stadium, but yeah, I mean it was well deserved. But like we're all boys, right? We're all like there's 20 of us in a group chat together, and we all just talk mad shit to each other. But yeah, I definitely. Like, we're all pretty good about putting our helmets on and letting that go, like letting our friendships like be one part and our racing be the other part. Mm-hmm. But it does definitely, like, you know, we hurt each other's feelings sometimes and we need like a week to like just avoid each other. But yeah, there's guys out there that I don't like at all. Mm-hmm. And there's guys that probably truly hate my guts, which I'm fine with, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, everyone's going to have their feelings, but... trying to separate friendships and business is a big deal for a lot of us to stay friends.
Yeah. Back on the making a living racing thing, you don't do the Nationals, right?
Mm-hmm.
World Supercross was a nice opportunity for you to...
Yeah, it was cool that Julian... I was technically contracted with Julian to do that all year. He let me out to do a Worlds deal, and it was cool of him to let me do it. I can make good money when I go do it. I even got to take my mechanic with me. And it gave me the opportunity to stay on a Supercross track all year. I mean, I took, you know, I think 2 months off this summer, not back to back because of how dumb the schedule was this year. But it just, I don't want to race outdoors if I don't have to. I regret not racing some and missing out on SMX stuff this year.
Yeah.
But Worlds is a lot of fun. I get to travel the world. You know, I got to take my wife to Australia for basically a free vacation. So, I definitely don't want to miss out on being able to get those opportunities to make money traveling the world, because I've learned so much about different cultures and just the way different people live by getting to do that. So it's so cool to me.
It's funny because remember, you're young, but you know, back in the day it was like, oh, last resort, my career is go to Europe or something. But it's like, dude, this dirt bike racing thing has taken you all these different places. It's pretty amazing.
Oh, I mean, going to Abu Dhabi to ride my dirt bike and, you know, whatever. We were in a basketball arena, but we were there for a week and we all just had, like, we all stayed at the same hotel. We all went everywhere together. We had a blast, you know, being able to just, you know, see a whole new world, basically, with your boys. It's too fun. We were having a blast.
Okay, this summer when you're not racing Worlds or Supercross is over, it looked like you did some mountain bike racing.
I did. Yeah, I've been racing downhill every chance I get. I enjoy the downhill bike. I mean, I like pedaling in general, but I feel at home when I get on my downhill bike. I think as soon as I'm done racing, I'm going to take it kind of serious. I wanted to go race the U.S. Open, but I was actually, it was the same weekend as Chicago. So I was actually supposed to race Chicago, so I didn't sign up for the U.S. Open. And then when I found out I couldn't race the Chicago, I couldn't sign up for the U.S. Open anymore. So it was a bummer, but I really like it, man. I feel like I'm pretty good at it, and I can get better at it. So that's definitely a goal of mine. I'm going to get to go to Whistler in June this year. And then, you know, I've spent a lot of time out west, like Angel Fire and a little bit of time in Colorado just riding the big bike. So it's something I want to get good at because I think I could be good at it.
Mm-hmm. Your wife's good on a mountain bike, too.
She is very good on a mountain bike. She doesn't get to ride as much anymore since we moved back east. But, I mean, we've got that new downhill park that Malale just built in North Carolina. So it's only 4 hours. So probably once a month we go over there. And she just has a enduro. But she's like, I mean, for, I hate to say this, but for a girl, she's great for, you know, getting to ride downhill maybe once a month. So
it's
a lot of fun.
During the Salt Lake COVID residency, is that when we first rode or was it the next year?
I think it was the next year. I don't think we really knew each other then yet. Because that was my first year back and I still sucked.
Well, no, I met you at the FXR.
Oh, yeah, that's right. When I was working for FXR. You're right. Yep.
But yeah, it's funny to think back on that whole COVID 3 week thing. Like,
I think that month, like, really, like, made my mountain bike career. Like, because that's all I did while I was there. I wasn't making mains. So, like, the next day, like, I was still had plenty of energy. I would just go mountain bike for 3 hours. And I think I rode bobsled like 100 times while I was there, you know?
Dude, it was so fun. But even to look back now, right? Like, COVID's still a thing, I guess, you know, because I had it a couple months ago. But to think back how scared everyone was back then, how weird the world was. But it's cool that we were part of that, right? Like that we were at Salt Lake and doing this 3 week post-up thing.
I think that was really cool. And even the next year was cool to me. Like,
yeah, like
doing like the two races at a stadium and getting to spend, you know, time places. I really liked that. I kind of wish Feld would do that some weekends where like we race on a Saturday in Dallas, then they flip the track and we race there again on freaking Wednesday or something.
Yeah.
Like, that would be cool to me. But yeah, man, it's strange looking back on it and just thinking like, man, like we couldn't leave the state and then race that same week. You know, like if we would have traveled away, we would get in trouble. But it was definitely a weird time to be a pro motocross rider.
Yeah, no people in the stand.
Yeah. It's such a weird vibe. Because that was that Eli's first title that he won?
I think so.
Yes, and he won it and no fans were there. And Chad retired, there were no fans there. It was just strange.
Yeah. What are your thoughts about the recent developments in the series, like the super motocross thing? And
I think it's cool. I think it's a lot of racing for 1 year. You know, all those guys that race, all 31, you know, you look at someone like Grant Harlan, like he raced every race all year long, had a killer year, and then he went to race 32 and got hurt. And it's like, you can only risk it so many times in a year, or you can only be so tired and crash and not get hurt. And I mean, like I said, I love riding my dirt bike, but outdoors is just a lot for me. And I've struggled with it basically ever since I had a heat stroke back in, you know, 2014 or whatever.
That sticks
it was.
With you.
And I just don't have that want to suffer outdoors anymore when I love riding supercross so much. So to be able to ride supercross all winter and then ride supercross part of the summer and into the fall, you know, but I do want to race the SMX races. It's just too good of money to not do it. And I think, you know, if two of them are going to be basically supercross anyways, I could do really good at them. So like we talked about this year, like it's almost a guarantee that I'm going to have to ride some outdoors, which I'm not scared of. You know, like I'm still good on a dirt bike outdoors. I'm not as good indoors, or not as good as I am indoors, but it's just going to be a work in progress, you know, and we're just going to knock out as many races as we feel we need to and see what happens.
Yeah. We're out of time now, but are you a good mud rider? It's supposed to be wet in San Francisco.
Dude, it is. It's supposed to rain all week. I think they already have the track built because it was supposed to
built
rain
and covered,
so much,
yeah.
But yeah, it's not my favorite thing, but we can get it done.
Yeah. Awesome. Hey, Cade, thanks for coming in. It's always a pleasure hanging out.
Yeah, buddy.
And good luck this weekend and through the rest of the series. Thanks for checking out the SML Show. Be sure to like and subscribe, and we'll see you next week.